So please join me in welcoming Congressman Kevin Yoder to Mission.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, and then last thing I want to talk about is just do sort of a little quick PowerPoint on spending. And I just want to share a few slides with you, just so we're sort of all on the same page on a few things. And so if I can... Okay. So just so we're all on the same page, when we talk about spending, when I'm on appropriations, and when we have a discussion about what the choices are before us, it's helpful to at least look at the pie. And I will say many folks haven't had a chance to look at these things, and I'm sure a lot of folks who even run your office haven't had a chance to get there. But you have really sort of three different segments of the federal budget. You have these two segments over here. You have non-defense discretionary spending, and you have defense spending. Those two items, you see, they equate to maybe $1.3 trillion, give or take. And then you have this portion of the pie, which includes Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, interest, and other
things. So, these are deficits we've been running by year since 1990, so you can get a perspective on the actual deficits we're running each year. So you can see in 1990, through about 96, we were running deficits between the two and four hundred million range. We ran surpluses from 98, 99 to 2000. And then 2002 to 2007, we continued to run deficits. And then the last 3 years, we've run the biggest deficits in U.S. history. And so the helpful part of this conversation is to try to
you're going to spend a portion of your day sending money to China or to other countries to service the debt on other spending, which means instead of building schools or roads or paying for Head Start or doing research here, we're going to do those things in other countries because we're going to be sending them money. It's going to be the largest transfer of wealth out of the United States oil and the rich in this country. Yeah. And solve the problem. So that comes up a lot in the conversation. And the facts are, and then we'll have a chance for folks to give their intelligent rebuttals. The facts are that for the president's proposal to tax big oil generates $20 billion over 10 years. It's $2 billion a year. Now we're talking about $1.6 trillion. Okay? So we're talking 1.6 trillion. And I promise if everybody will wait, everybody can have a chance to give a common response. Like, I understand there's two sides to this debate. So $2 billion. And then the proposal to raise taxes on the upper 1%. Let the tax cut expire for that portion. Raises $60 billion a year, or $600 billion over 10 years. So what you end up having is a situation where you cannot raise taxes enough. 86%, and the top 50% of taxpayers pay 97% of the tax burden. So government spending as a percentage of GDP, this historical path is government spending as a percentage of GDP. And then your current path, the current pathway we're on here will take us to a point where we're about a percentage of 50% of GDP at this point. By making reductions in spending, we can keep our spending as a percentage of GDP as a historical average. Regardless of where we are in taxes, you cannot spend money at that rate.
Taxes as a percentage of GDP?
How much is it?
So the Medicare issue is one that has come up a lot and has been part of a lot of the discussion. We have two choices on Medicare. And I understand there's people on both sides. I want to talk about the different sides, what I believe to be the correct path, and then I'm sure someone can articulate the other side. First of all, the path that we're on is if you're 55 or above, there's no change to Medicare. So how many folks in the room are 55 or above?
Okay.
So 55 and above, no changes to Medicare, no disruptions, and you preserve and protect Medicare. Your system of health insurance similar to what I have, similar to the members of Congress have, similar to federal employees have. Wealthy get less, sick and low income get more support, so it's mean how the president's plan uses rationing board for benefit provider cuts, imposes nearly $10,000 cut per senior, does not save Medicare, because the president's plan to handle these Medicare proposals is to have a 15-person board that will essentially tell doctors or tell hospitals that they're going to pay less, and that they're going to ration care. And so the challenge is can you find a way to save Medicare, particularly the seniors that are on it right now, and preserve for generations going forward, and avoid Medicare going bankrupt? And so that's the real challenge for the debate in this country. The good thing is that we are having a very healthy debate about this in Washington. The president has a proposal, the House has a proposal, members of Congress are frequently meeting with the president so that we can come together as a country and try to solve this problem, because nobody wins if both sides sit in their tents and tell the other side they're completely wrong. And so that's my goal, is to try to find ways in which we can discuss these issues. I know there are other sides in the debate, and we have this challenge.
Here's my concern. I was born and raised as a person, and my Jesus says, "You heal the sick, you feed the hungry, and when you do this to the least of them, you're doing it to me." And yet, what we've seen from the Ryan bill is something that, from the budget that he proposed, is something that's not going to do any of that, and it will hurt Medicare folks like me, who are going to be headed to our Medicare, and it's going to be giving vouchers. Excuse me, I lost my job 2.5 years ago. I want to make health insurance.
That was his principle in the statement, so I think there's a chance there where the parties could come together and figure out a way to do tax reform, and that's a real opportunity, I think, for us to actually get something done. And that's the whole thing, is we've got to get something done in Washington, and that means we're going to have to give and take, and we're going to have to work together. So I think that's one where the parties can work together. The Medicare plan's a little different than what you described, and I understand that there may be frustration with whatever it is, but the plan doesn't give you a voucher and say you have to the private market. Puts you in a similar situation than what federal employees have, which is when there are 4 or 5 or 6 different plans, or maybe more, you could choose from, and you receive premium assistance to go into one of those plans. There, you will get a plan. You're required to have, they're going to require those that will offer a plan. If you have a pre-existing condition, or you pay, or you have your lower income, then you'll have more premium assistance. It's a means-tested plan where the poorer pay less, the richer pay more. But I do agree with you. I think we have to figure out a way to preserve Medicare. I think we have to figure out a way to...
I would much rather have a business that's flourishing, but it can't flourish in this economy. In my mind, and I think in